Pakistan has been supporting terrorism in a big way in Jammu and Kashmir. Because Kashmir, as far as Pakistan is concerned, is an unfinished agenda. And they will not rest till the time Kashmir becomes a part of Pakistan. So whatever amount of peace talks you can have, it is unlikely that we are going to have peace in due course. How is Pakistan supporting? Pakistan is supporting the militancy there by various means. Their support is given here. They help new recruits to infiltrate or exfiltrate. They give them training. They give them equipment, that is arms and ammunition. They give them funding. And it is the ISI which carries out coordination. These are the photographs of various militants who were killed and their identity cards also. But most of the names given here are generally fake. The name given may not be true, though it's a proper identity card, but it doesn't mean the name given here and this person is the same, because there's always a fake identity. So Pakistan has been carrying out a lot of things. There are a lot of terrorist camps which are there in Pakistan. The number varies from 40 to 50. Initially, these camps were located mostly in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. After Americans started operating from Pakistan into Afghanistan, these camps now have been shifted back from the line of control into deeper into Kashmir, and some camps have now gone into Pakistan, Punjab and Pakistan, Balochistan also. Meaning they have spread the camps to a number of other places inside Pakistan so that identifying them is not easy. Some of the photographs of this Pakistani, the terrorist camps which are there. What is to be understood is that these camps are always co-located with villages in Pakistan. It is not as if you can go and attack them by air, because if you ever carry out firing there, you are more likely to kill some innocent Pakistani civilians also. They are merged into each other, and that has been done by a purpose so that nobody can attack them. Now look at the terrorist strength in Pakistan. I have not gone, because of the slight problems, I have only given the figures from 2000, but at one point of time in 1988, the number of armed militants in Kashmir was about in excess of 8,000. This figure fell to 3,500 in 2002, 2,100, 1,400, 752,000, and today in 2013, the estimate is that it may be something less than 300. So today, the violence purely by virtue of firing and that kind is now reducing drastically. But now a different kind of an warfare is taking place. So really, have we turned the tide? We were still thinking that we have turned the tide simply because the number of militants has fallen down. But suddenly 2013, the level of violence increased in Jammu and Kashmir. We had the Kiran incidents in which terrorists infiltrated in a big way. We had the Samba terror attack in which they went into the family camps of Indian Army at a place called Samba. Then, in addition to that, they tried to ambush a column of Indian Army going into Kashmir. This had not happened for last about 10 years when they directly fought the Indian Army. They were just scared of tackling the Indian Army. But in 2013, while the number of civilians killed is very less as compared to the earlier figures, the number of soldiers and army officers who have been killed is one of the highest in recent times. So which possibly indicates that now special forces people of Pakistani army have also possibly infiltrated into India, because a normal terrorist is not simply capable of attacking an army convoy. If army camps and convoys have been attacked, obviously some very specially trained people have come inside. There are a lot of books on Kashmir, but Kashmir is till the time the jihadi training factories in Pakistan are stopped, this problems in Kashmir will not stop, because some people are under the impression that you improve governance, you improve administration, proxy war, terrorism will disappear from there. It will not. Though good governance is definitely required, but that doesn't mean that the problems there will start. So today the terrorists are changing their strategies every day. Now they are infiltrating more from international border. Some of them are coming from the coastline, some of them are coming from Bangladesh, some of them are coming from Nepal. So various things are being done. So as far as our tackling this problem is concerned, there are five prongs which we use to carry out anti-proxy war operations in Kashmir. First prong is effective surveillance of the line of control, meaning not letting any new terrorist come from Pakistan into India, and not permitting Kashmiri youth to exfiltrate from India into Pakistan. This is now more or less effective, but as I mentioned earlier, that they are now infiltrating from the international border. Second prong is carrying out anti-infiltration operations inside. The third prong is whoever is infiltrated inside the country, carrying out operations against them. That is what is done in the hinterland. The fourth is winning the hearts and minds of Kashmiri people. And fourth is an effective media management. Because despite doing a lot of good things, some of the Kashmiris are not convinced that the Indian government is looking after them. I will just give you one example of this. Today, as far as economics is concerned, if you compare the state of Maharashtra with that of Jammu and Kashmir, Maharashtra today gets 70% of aid from central government as loans, and 30% is supposed to be grant, meaning it is just given to you. While in Kashmir, it is 90% grant, meaning everything is given free of cost to them. Today, Kashmiris get subsidized water, subsidized ration, subsidized everything. Kashmir today generates absolutely no revenue. They are economically so dependent on government of India that if they want to pay money to their own employees, they are not capable of doing it. Economy of Kashmir only depends upon the government of India only. The only way Kashmiri economy can be improved is by getting the industry there. No industry will come there till the time they get land. Article 370 is a big hindrance there because you're not permitted to buy land there. Tourism is one thing which can really put Kashmiri economy into good lines, because Kashmir is an attractive place. The tourists are increasing, but it can be increased much more than what is happening, because that is one thing which will give employment to the local Kashmiri people there. In addition to that, we have to create those kind of industries which do not require an infrastructure, because Kashmir is a mountainous area. So maybe information technology based industry, if it's taken there, that is one thing which can save this country. But as far as militancy is concerned, terrorism is concerned, it is being fought in a big way. Today, there is a unified approach to fighting militancy. In that case, there is a very good coordination between various agencies of government of India. And today we find that things are improving. This slide, I would like you to have a look at it, because how does an infiltration take place into Kashmir? What is shown here is the line of control. This side is Pakistan, this side is Kashmir / India. Now what happens is the recruits are trained there, thereafter they are funded there, thereafter they are motivated, and then they are told to cross over the line of control at the time of night time and infiltrate into India. Generally they cross over from the AC in a groups of 8 to 10. Generally 95% of them get killed on the line of control itself. 5% may succeed in crossing this line of limit of infiltration and getting deep into India, and the ones who get inside Kashmir are the ones who create problems for us. And this is one indication as to how many encounters have taken place on the line of control itself. And today the residual militancy in Kashmir may be less than 300 people. There are some forested areas inside Kashmir where the residual militants may be there. And if you have a look at the figures of militants killed, surrendered and all, you will find that the figures year wise is given here, it is very, very large. People who have been, the militants who have been killed, people who have been surrendered, and that kind of a thing. So today there are a lot of confidence building measures that have taken place, opening of the Uri Muzaffarabad road, etc. Then today the tourist arrivals in the valley is increasing. Today the polling percentage over the period of time has been increasing in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Pilgrimage to Amarnath, that number is also increasing. Various links to Pakistan have been opened up so that divided families, if any, can meet each other. The Kashmiri economy has done quite well. It is one of the GDP and the per capita income today in Kashmir is one of the better in our country today. In fact, the poorest state today in our country is Bihar. And Kashmir, in terms of economic indicators, comes at number 7 or number 8, meaning they are quite well off. The amount of money that government of India has pumped into Kashmir is so huge that today, if you take a 500 rupee note or a 1000 rupee note, which is of this size, you can literally lay a carpet of 1000 rupee notes into entire Kashmir. The only problem has been that this money, Mr. Rajiv Gandhi had very famously said, that not even 15% of the development money reaches common people, 85% gets siphoned off in between. But maybe he was wrong. In Kashmir, 95% of money gets siphoned off. In other places, it is lesser that gets siphoned off. In Kashmir, the corruption is complete. Today, if you see the houses of politicians and the bureaucrats in Jammu and see their houses, they all are disproportionate houses as compared to the known sources of income. A person who retires as a constable from a police owns 4 to 5 bungalows. This is the kind of money that is gathered over a period of time. And the neo-rich of Kashmir today are the bureaucrats and the politicians over there. And if you go and see their houses next to Dal Lake and in those VIP areas of Kashmir, you will find that they are much bigger and better than the rich people of the rest of the country. Anyway, Kashmir is today improving and a lot of good things have happened. And this is what Atal Bihari Vajpayee had said in 1999 when he went to Lahore. He said, Bharat pa padosi, saath saath rehna hai, pyaar kare ya waar kare, dono ko hi sehna hai. Jo hum par guzri, bachcho ke sang na hone denge, jang na hone denge, jang na hone denge. This poem which he sang in Lahore in 1999 was a hit with the media. But singing poems is one good thing, but that is exactly the same time when Pakistan was preparing for infiltration into state of Kargil, and we had the Kargil war immediately after this. So as far as Kashmir is concerned, Delhi bahut dur hai, violence will continue for some time to come. Though while we should improve our governance, we should improve our anti-terrorist operations, we should look after Kashmiri people, but till the time the factories of jihadi terrorism are intact in Kashmir, these problems are going to continue. We will just talk. 2010, in Kashmir, the stone terrorism had reached its peak, and every day 1 to 2 people were killed. Now see the amount of violence which took place in 2010, and at this point of time, Kashmir economy came to a standstill almost for a period of 2 to 3 months. Government property was burnt. They started targeting police and CRPF. They just look at it. The industry from Kashmir Valley, whichever little industry was there, they went outside the valley. Tourist inflow into Kashmir Valley dropped down to an all-time low. So this is what the Kashmiris have to pay, in case the violence goes on there. Somehow today there's a feeling that more outrageous anti-national statements you make, you get invited for talks. Mrs. Arundhati Roy held a seminar called Azadi, the Only Way Ahead in Kashmir, in Delhi, about just 2 kilometers from the headquarters of Home Ministry. She should have been prosecuted under the law of the land, but nothing happened to her. Public diplomacy today is a very neglected field. Even when nothing wrong is happening, lot of people in Kashmir, especially in the valley, believe that a lot of injustice is being done to them. Lot of people in the rest of India also believe that we are doing a bit of injustice to the Kashmiri brothers, which is not the case. Today Kashmir gets highest per capita aid. If there's a problem of money not reaching the proper people, it is because of bad governance which is happening in Kashmir. Unfortunately, as far as the battle of hearts and minds of people is concerned, it is the job of Information Broadcasting Ministry we should be doing it, but nobody seems to be doing it except the Indian Army. How to win them? We have to tell them that Army is not the enemy. They kept on sort of making outrageous allegation against the Indian Army. Army is there because government of India has sent them there today. If government of India feels that Army should not be there, it is can always tell Indian Army to vacate Kashmir. Only thing, government of India should have guts to say so. But they make Army as a whipping boy and show as if the problems in Kashmir are because of Indian Army. Any government is empowered to take out Army from anywhere, but they should do it. Another important thing is when they talk of reducing Army pressure, they talk of reducing security forces. It is not known today that all the politicians of Kashmir today are moving around in bulletproof vehicles, and there's a posse of at least 50 to 100 policemen who accompanies people like Mr. Umar Abdullah and Mrs. Ms. Mehbooba Mufti, the leader of opposition. If there's a peace in Kashmir, why can't she move in normal cars as politicians, let's say in rest of the country do? If Kashmir is very safe, why is government of Kashmir secretariat in Srinagar converted into a fortress? Why don't you keep it open for the public? We don't have a fortress today around our Mandralay. I mean, it is just there in the heart of Pune, but heart of Mumbai. But try entering the secretariat of Jammu and Kashmir. You'll have to go through 10 layers of security. Please remove the security there if you think that the threat has disappeared. Somehow, a lot of disinformation campaign takes place. I gave some examples of how disinformation campaign is taking place. But what is important today is that we need to launch a proper information war in which we need to educate people of Kashmir, people of rest of India, international community on what is the true situation in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. And this is the job of every ministry. Ministry of External Affairs has to explain to the rest of the world the true situation. Ministry of Home Affairs has to ensure that this is done in the rest of India. Ministry of Information and Broadcasting has to do it in Kashmir. We have to make our Doordarshan effective, we have to make our radios effective, we have to make newspapers effective and ensure that what is important today is Kashmiriyat, which is important, and not radicalization. I am Brigadier Hemant Mahajan, who is putting nearly 37 years of service in the Indian Army. I was commissioned into 7th Maratha Light Infantry, one of the famous battalions of Indian Army, in June 1975. During my service, I have taken part on all the operations in which Indian Army participated from 1975 onwards. I have taken part on anti-terrorist operation in Jammu and Kashmir, anti-infiltration operations which Indian Army did again on the line of control in Jammu and Kashmir. During the peak of terrorism in Punjab, we were involved in Operation Raksha in Punjab. In addition to this, I have served on the Rajasthan and the other Pakistani, Indo-Pakistan borders. I have served on the Indo-China borders, on the Indo-Myanmar borders. And we have taken part in various operations which took place, including serving in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. For all the action that we did in Kashmir, my battalion was awarded unit citation and about 19 gallantry awards. When I was commanding a brigade in Jammu and Kashmir, again a lot of awards were won by my brigade. My last 4 years of my service in the army, I joined Army War College, where I was teaching officers of the rank of colonels in the higher command course. After my retirement on 31st January 2009, I've been writing very regularly in various newspapers on various facets of national security, both in Marathi and in English. I've been taking part on various debates on the TV channels, in the Marathi TV channels, 24 hours news channels, Hindi TV channels, and also some of the English TV channels. In addition to this, we are taking part in many seminars based upon national security. I'm a member of two think tanks, Center for Advanced Strategic Studies based in Pune, and Forum for Integrated National Security, which is based in Bombay. One is involved in talking on various facets of national security on many talks which are coordinated by various NGOs. For my service in the army, I was awarded Yuddha Seva Medal for the good work that I had done, a gallantry award in Kashmir. In addition, I have been awarded Chief of Army Staff's Commendation Card. Swatantra Veer Savarkar Rashtriya Smarak asked me to I am on the working committee of Swatantra Veer Savarkar Rashtriya Smarak, and on their behalf we have produced some films covering various facets of national security. The films include India's external security, that is how we should deal with China and Pakistan. Second is how should we deal with our borders during peacetime with Bangladesh, with Nepal, Myanmar and Sri Lanka. How should we look after the coastal security? We face serious internal security problems. We have covered four of these. These are the extent, the nationalism in our country today is increasing exponentially. How do we counter the threat of nationalism or Maoism? Kashmir proxy war is still going on. What else can we do in Kashmir? Northeast India is being converted into a Bangladesh. How do we meet the challenge of stopping Bangladeshization of Northeast? And how do we stop bomb blasts that are taking place in the rest of the country? All these films are in English. One film is in Marathi, in which we have spoken as to how do we take on the challenge of the Chinese dragon. In addition, there is one film on motivation. One young soldier, Lieutenant Vijayan Thapar, how he sacrificed his life. It's a film which will motivate the younger generation. I am sure that you will enjoy listening to these films, and you should pass it on to You should pass on the contents of this videos to as many friends and relations as possible, so that the spirit of national security is imbibed by every citizen of the country. Jai Hind.